Like his heavenly father and do like Jesus did. The quality of people is very critical. So with this in mind, let's study today's passage and see Jesus' work for a blind and mute man. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you so much for blessing us with this time that we can gather in Jesus' name to worship our Lord and to learn about the kingdom of God. Please guide us through this passage. Grant us your Holy Spirit. May our eyes be open, may our ears be open, may our hearts be softened to receive your holy words this time. Please speak to us individually and corporately as your body, that we might really be blessed through this time studying the Word of God. We thank you and we pray these things in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen. Part 1, they beg Jesus. Let's look at verses 31 and 32. Okay, let's read together. Okay, let's go. Then Jesus left the city of Tyre and went through Sidon, down to the Sea of Galilee and into the region of the Decapolis. There some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly talk, and they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. So our passage begins with a little bit of geography describing where Jesus was leaving and where he was going. And it's kind of an interesting path that he's taking, because in this one short verse 31, there's quite a bit of land that's covered. So I put together a little map here. So in our previous passage, Jesus was in the region of Tyre. And then today's passage says that he went up into Sidon, which is north. And then he passed through Galilee and then down into the Decapolis. And the Decapolis is this territory, as you can see, with the border around it that represented 10 cities. We don't know how far into the Decapolis. I just kind of put it, kind of in the middle there. But you can see that, you know, in between these four locations, do you think that Jesus had said a lot of things? Do you think that maybe he did a lot of events in that time of traveling? I think the answer is yes. So the question is, why in Mark chapter 7 is there just two events that are described? The previous passage, which was the Syrophoenician woman, and then today's passage, which is the deaf and mute man who was healed. I think if we look at Mark chapter 7, we can find out why Mark focused on just two events to talk about, even though Jesus most likely did tons of things in this time of traveling from Tyre to Sidon to Galilee to the Decapolis. So why just these two events? When we look at Mark chapter 7, we see that there's three main pieces to it. The first part we actually spent 2 weeks discussing is the part where traditions and the defilement of food was discussed. And a couple highlights from that was, and this is from the first part of Mark, was Jesus said to the religious leaders, you have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. So the criticism here by the Lord was that the religious leaders, they love the traditions of man. And they paid so much attention to those traditions, but they set aside the commands of God, the things that God had to say, in order to uphold and to practice the things that they made up for themselves. And then kind of in the conclusion of that first section of Mark 7, Jesus said, again, Jesus called the crowds to him and said, listen to me, everyone, and understand this. See, there was a big problem. The people were not listening to God. They were not listening to Jesus. And they did not understand God. And they did not understand Jesus. So he said, listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them. Now, in 2019, we can think to ourselves, oh, gosh, why didn't they understand something so obvious? You know, you put some food inside your mouth, and it's not going to make you defile before God. It's what comes out of your heart that makes you either defile or not. And so Jesus said in verse 17, after he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. And look at this. This is shocking. Are you so dull, he asked? Don't you see that nothing that enters a person from the outside can defile them? So when we look at this first part of Mark 7, there was a problem that people didn't get. Whether they were disciples, religious leaders, or the crowds, people just were completely unaware of what God really thought. They couldn't understand what Jesus was saying, so Jesus even told his own disciples, are you so dull? Don't you get it? And instead of focusing on what God was saying, they focused on things like traditions. And that's what gave us the previous passage, the Syrophoenician woman's faith. Now, what was the Syrophoenician? Was she a Jewish person? No. And what did Jesus imply that she was? A dog, that's right. Now, I brought a picture of my dog. Okay? Now, this is it. Okay. I can talk a lot about my dog, but I'm just going to kind of use a little... So, in my household, my wife spends a lot of time preparing delicious meals for our children. And one of the things that aggravates me and her, and by the way, we love our kids, they're so precious, but the one way that my dog is better than my kids is this dog will eat anything. But in the case of my wife, she spends a lot of time cooking delicious meals, and sometimes the kids are like, oh, I don't really want this. I want, you know, mac and cheese, or, you know, they're very picky. They don't really see how much good things have been provided for them. They don't take the opportunity, you know, and really just take in the goodness that their mom creates for them. But this dog, he'll eat anything. He'll eat the trash. Like the stuff that we were gonna eat but we threw out, he eats it all. Like, he just got in the trash yesterday to clean up everything. But it's his good point. The Syrophoenician woman's good point was that she was not worthy to have the bread that was for the children, but she was like a dog. She just let me have a crumb. And she really put a contrast and put in check the people of Jesus' time who were being offered bread from the Lord, from God, and they were just, they didn't even try to eat it. They just like were too, they stuck their noses up at it. But this Syrophoenician woman just wanted crumbs. So she had a really great faith and a great attitude. Now, that also was just like the first story. And then the second story today is the deaf and mute man. So I think the point here is that in the previous passage, we had the traditions defilement of eating certain foods. And it makes, I think even Pastor John said the first, you know, first part of Mark was like kind of heavy, kind of negative, right? Like lots of Jesus not happy, and, you know, he's, you know, calling people hypocrites, which is the truth. But if you look at the Syrophoenician woman, we see that it is going to balance out Mark chapter 7. It's going to give us a good examples that balance out the bad examples that we saw in the first part. So let's look at our passage a little bit more carefully here. So he left the vicinity of Tyre and went through the Sidon down to the Sea of Galilee and into the region of Decapolis. So what happened in Decapolis is this. There are some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly talk, and they begged Jesus to place his hand on them. Now, a couple of things jump out at us. But I think the first thing that jumps out is not that the man was deaf and mute, or could hardly talk, but it's that the people brought him to Jesus and they begged Jesus. If you look at the Syrophoenician woman, you see also that expression, beg Jesus. Begging Jesus is a very expression that maybe, you know, it's like, well, I don't like to beg anybody, you know, like, but begging Jesus gets results. Begging Jesus opens the door to get great blessings from Jesus. And it can't be misunderstood how important it is to beg Jesus for something. When you beg for something, it shows that one of two things. One, you really want it. Or secondly, that you really need it. When you beg Jesus, it shows the Lord that you really want something. And when God sees that you really want something, more times than not, he will grant it to you. And when Jesus sees that you really need something, more times than not, he will grant it to you. You know, I think all of us, you know, who have kids know what it's like when your children just ask you for something and you can tell that they're not very serious about it versus when they beg you. You know, I have a policy in my house that my kids aren't allowed to stay over at friends' houses unless it's a friend from our church here. This is my own policy that my wife and I have. But my son, he kept on begging me, Dad, come on. Yeah, there's a neighbor friend who we know their family really well. He's like, Dad, please, why do we have this rule? And he begged me, and then so I started like thinking, okay, maybe like once every 3 months I'll let them spend the night. You know. But anyway, just to be clear, if it's a birthday party, I'll let them spend the night. But just for randomly, I don't want, you know, some Friday night, like three of my kids are somewhere and, you know, across Downey and people's house. I just don't want that. But anyways, my son begged me, so then I even started to think a little bit more about my policy. You know, should I reform it? How much more when we beg Jesus to help our friends or to help ourselves to become a more whole person. So these people brought a man who was deaf and could hardly talk. So this man, and we know by today's knowledge that when you're deaf, even if you were a fully, like you had no issues, no infirmities at all, if you go deaf, eventually what happens to your speech? It starts getting a little bit weird. Even if you, because you can't hear yourself, there's like some kind of feedback loop that when you hear yourself speaking, you can, you know, mimic the right sounds. But when you lose your hearing, you can't hear yourself anymore, so then the way you talk starts to get a little bit hard to understand. You end up talking either too loud, or the pitch, or the tone gets off from normal speech. So this man can talk, he can make noises, but it definitely was not the kind of intelligible or communicative speech that people shared most of the time. So he couldn't hear, and he couldn't. His input was bad, and his output was bad as well. So they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. And let's look at our part two, the opening. Let's look at verses 33 to 35. Let's read these responses. I'll go first. After he took him aside, away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. The man's ears were open, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. So after he took him aside from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears, then spit and touched the man's tongue. Now I wonder, like, did Jesus, like, spit on the ground and then touch the man's tongue? So I looked at every single Bible translation, and it seems that indeed Jesus did spit on his fingers and then touch the man's tongue. So it's I think we should say like Fuji, right, when he was singing this song about that part or something. It's a little bit gross, but I think it has an important spiritual meaning. The first thing is that Jesus took him aside. He took him away from the crowd. Now, in order to receive a healing, Jesus oftentimes would take people away from the crowds. In the next chapter, Jesus is going to heal a blind man. In a similar way, he's going to use his saliva, and he's going to touch the man's eyes, but first he's going to take that blind man away from the crowd as well. You can check it out. So this solitude time with Jesus was a first step in order for his healing to take place. It wasn't going to be through some other person. It wasn't going to be with a big, you know, event. It was alone time, solitude time with Jesus in direct communication and relationship with him and him alone. But then Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. He touched his ears. Jesus took his fingers, in essence, you know, put them inside of his ears. Usually we think of like putting your fingers in your ears like, you know, blocking things out. But I think in this case, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears to touch his ears. And then he spit and touched the man's tongue. Jesus could have healed this man without doing these things. But these are very symbolic and important gestures to tell us the spiritual truth. Whether we're an unbeliever or even disciples of Jesus, we need Jesus to touch our ears. We need Jesus to touch our ears so that we can hear God more accurately. Now, some people, they're hard of hearing. But if somebody's hard of hearing, their hearing's like, it's not completely gone, but it's like, their hearing's like not so great. What do you have to do in order to communicate to them like that? You have to shout. They can hear, but you have to shout at them. And I wonder, does God have to shout at us? Does he have to bring some big event or some real explicit person or point into our lives in order for us to hear him? Does he have to just shout at us to make us hear him and to hear directions from him? Has Jesus touched our ears in a way that we can hear God so well as if it, in the same way as if you can hear a pin drop? You know, back in the days, AT&T, you know, when people had like landlines, their big marketing scheme was, you know, they show like a telephone and then they show a pin dropping and then bouncing. Like, our phone lines are so good that you can hear a pin drop. And so the question is, has Jesus touched our ears, opened our hearts, so that we can hear even the faintest direction from our Lord, from the Holy Spirit? Do we have ears to hear the Word of God? Even the smallest details of the Word of God. Is God able to communicate to us through the Word of God? Has Jesus touched our ears and made us say we can truly hear even the pin drop? And then he spit and touched the man's tongue. Now what's very fascinating is that, like we kind of talked about, when you hear well, usually you can speak well. In the same way, when we hear God and we have good ears to hear, usually that means that we can speak well as a result. Jesus spit and touched the man's tongue. He gave this man the ability to talk. Now there's a lot of people in this world who can talk. If you think about like from God's point of view, you know, God's in heaven. When he, you know, so to speak, looks down on this world, he sees a lot of deaf people who also can't say anything worthwhile. Think about all the talking that happens in this world, but yet is anybody saying anything that's really that useful? So much chit-chat and talking and boasting and false ideas, lies, all kinds of things are coming off of man's tongues that is of no value in the kingdom of heaven. It's in fact an anti-kingdom of heaven. It's as if a bunch of people were just sort of just yelling and they can't hear and then they just keep talking. It's just chaos. But when Jesus touches our tongue, we're able to say things that are worthy of the kingdom of heaven. Things that lift up other people. Things, it's amazing. We're able to say things that even Jesus himself would say. He gives us the power through his grace, through the touching work of his power in our lives, that we can even say the things that Jesus would say. Now, of course, we're not going to canonize that and make it into the Bible, but the point is that when the Holy Spirit works in us, when Jesus touched our tongue, we don't say the evil things we used to say, but instead we say heavenly things, we say things of the kingdom of heaven. That's a great blessing. And so here's another question, just in the same question like about, you know, do we have ears to hear God's words well? Another question is, what comes off of my tongue? Has Jesus touched my tongue to the point where what I say is of the kingdom of heaven, you know, 100% of the time? I can't say what I say is 100% of the time the things of the kingdom of heaven or what Jesus would say. And so therefore, I really pray that Jesus would touch my tongue so that less things of William would come off of my tongue and more things of Jesus would come off of my tongue. May the Lord touch our ears so that we can hear God. May the Lord touch our tongue so that we can say the things of God. Verse 34, he looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, "Ephphatha," which means be opened. At this, the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. So in these next verses, Jesus looked up to heaven, and with a deep sigh said to him, "Ephphatha," which means be opened. So I want to ask the question, why did Jesus make a deep sigh? You know, there's all kinds of sighs, right? There's a sigh of relief, like, ooh, you know, like you get pulled over by the policeman and then you pray and you're like, "Lord, please let me get out of this ticket," and then the policeman just lets you off with a warrant and then you make a big sigh. Oh, sigh of relief, right? Or, you know, you work really hard, you go to the campus, you know, you teach the Word of God, you meet some new Bible students, you know, or you go home and you cook some dinner for your family. You work really hard, and then you sit in your bed, and then what kind of sigh do you let off? It's tired, like, oh, you know, that kind of sigh, right? But in this case, this is not a sigh of relief or a sigh of tiredness. This is a sigh of sorrow. He looked up to heaven with a deep sigh and said to him, "Ephphatha." Why was Jesus sighing deeply? I think it's because the gravity of what we saw in the last passage. A people who don't hear, a people who don't speak. Even his own disciples, he said, "Are you so dull?" This was very heavy. You know, sometimes we don't see the world the way Jesus sees the world because we're not at that point. But when you think about what he was going through, he was sent to heaven to make a people. But the people were not listening. They were dull. Even the best were so dull still. And so this man before him was like an embodiment of the situation and circumstances of Israel. So he looked up to his heavenly Father and in prayer with a deep sigh, but yet with faith, he prayed and he declared, "Be opened." And the man's ears were opened. This was not just a prayer for this man. This was a prayer for the generation, for his disciples, for you and for me. Jesus looks up to heaven and with a deep sigh, knowing our clogged up ears and our hardened hearts, he prays. He opens and declares it by faith. Let's give thanks to God that our Lord, our Savior, loves us so much that he prays and overcomes our, you know, there's when you look at ourselves, there's not much to be hopeful for. But by faith, Jesus prays to our Heavenly Father on our behalf and declares that our ears will be opened to hear God and that our tongues will be loosened so that we can speak the things of God. At this, the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. You know, he was speaking plainly in terms of this, you know, worldly language, but of course we mean, the real meaning is that we would speak the language of the kingdom. We speak plainly in terms of how God thinks of speaking plainly. But let's look at part 3. He has done everything well. Let's look at these verses. Let's read them together. Let's go. Jesus commanded them not to tell anyone, but the more he did so, the more they kept talking about it. People were overwhelmed with amazement. "He has done everything well," they said. "He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak." Here we see that the people were overwhelmed with amazement. He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak. The efficacy of Jesus was undeniable. You know, the word efficacy, I like this word because, you know, it's sort of like a version of effective, right? Sometimes, you know, things are not always effective, and so you don't really want to put your hope in them because the effectiveness is, you know, debatable. But in terms of Jesus, the effectiveness, the ability to produce a desired result, Jesus' efficacy is overwhelming, and his ability is complete. We should put our faith in Jesus. We should have a begging topic to bring to him because his efficacy is testified to in this passage. He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak. For sure, we need to put our hope in Jesus and bring a begging topic to Jesus so that we can experience his effectiveness to heal us of our hearing and our speaking. So in conclusion, we learn from today's passage that Jesus has come from heaven to make a people who can hear, who can speak. It's important to God that we not just be saved of our sins, but that we start portraying the characteristics and the qualities of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus really cares about this. He even sighs deeply when he sees that his disciples are dull and the generation is not listening. But yet he still prays and with effectiveness opens the ears and loosens the tongue of his people. So may we give thanks to God that we have such a Lord and such a Savior. And may we also produce a begging topic that we can bring to Jesus and experience his power and his effectiveness to bring healing into our lives and the lives of our loved ones. Let's look at our keepers and pray together. He looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, "Ephatha," which means be open. One word, be open. Father in heaven, thank you so much for blessing us with this passage. Thank you for Jesus who brought healing to the generation, to his disciples, that their ears would be open, that they'd be able to hear God, and that they'd be able to say the things of God, speak the language of the kingdom of heaven. May you bless us as a church body that we would have better hearing. May we spend time with Jesus alone so he can touch our ears and touch our tongues and change us from who we are into becoming the people that he really wants us to be. Thank you so much for his love and care for us and his faith in God for us. We thank you and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand and say our hymn.